Kung Fu, the ultimate guide to Shaolin Kung Fu, along with its movements and techniques. Written by Clint Sharp, narrated by Ivan Busenius. Introduction. Most people's first introduction to martial arts was either through movies or TV shows. Strong, steadfast, disciplined heroes fight seemingly impossible odds with nothing more than their arms, their hands, their legs, and their feet. These heroes are ambassadors. They introduce the art form to audiences outside of China and Hong Kong. And you don't have to live in either of those places to learn Kung Fu properly. This audiobook is your portal to the dojos and the kuns. From the comfort of your own home and working at your own pace, you too can perform the dazzling kicks and purposeful movements of Kung Fu. Whether you're a novice or you already have some training under your belt, this audiobook is designed to not only further your knowledge of martial art, but to enhance the positive ripples that learning it can spread into every facet of your life. Kung Fu is more than just learning how to throw punches and kicks. It's all about discipline. This martial art is a fantastic way to get in and stay in great physical shape. In today's hectic and often demanding world, it can be a fantastic outlet to relieve stress and anxiety. Sharpening your body sharpens your mind, and it improves your concentration. On your journey with this audiobook, you can discover the self-confidence you may lack or bolster the one that you already have. By learning Kung Fu with this guide, you'll be connected, if not physically, in spirit, with all the practitioners who came before you. You'll join an ancient community, all sharing the goals of learning self-defense and improving themselves. Kung Fu is an art that promotes self-expression. You can take the foundations and expand on them to form something uniquely your own. Like a painter, this audiobook will provide you with the paint, the brushes, and the canvas. And it'll teach you how to paint while leaving the final product up to you. Chapter 1. What is Kung Fu? Well, before learning Kung Fu, it is paramount to understand where it came from. To get the most out of this audiobook's lessons and the martial art itself, obtaining a firm grasp on its history and origins is essential. These are the building blocks that the discipline is built on. Like those of a house, these foundations help keep the whole structure together and prevent it from falling apart. There are several accepted definitions or translations of Kung Fu. Some interpret it as work and effort. Others feel that the translation to hard work of a man is more accurate. Whatever your interpretation, there are always two elements, hard work and dedication. Mastering martial arts requires both. The origins of Kung Fu are disputed. With a country as old and as rich in history as China, narrowing it down to a single source is seemingly impossible. Now that said, there are mythological and historical breadcrumbs that you can follow to establish a rough timeline to the martial arts' origin. Many believe the beginnings of what would eventually become Kung Fu started with the introduction and spread of martial arts throughout China. Later known as the Yellow Emperor, Hongdi was thought to have written some of the first guides on military tactics and self-defense techniques that would evolve into a fighting discipline. According to legends, the stars foretold the Yellow Emperor's birth and great destiny. Born into a time of great strife and warring tribes, Hongdi would unite the different tribes that lived along the Yellow River. Unified, these groups became the first version of the Chinese state. The Yellow Emperor not only influenced the political and military landscape of China, but he also was a forefather of Chinese medicine. His philosophies and medical discoveries would later evolve into some of the central tenets of Kung Fu. Those writings are some of the oldest ever discovered in the history of mankind. After the legendary Yellow Emperor passed away, his martial arts teachings continued and were built upon. Centuries of small-scale warfare between feudal lords over everything from land rights to personal affronts enveloped a still young China. In this phase, Hongdai's philosophies on martial arts, warfare, and self-improvement were adopted and adapted by different regions of the vast country. The Yellow Emperor's philosophies evolved into ancient China's six arts. Extremely similar to the Western concept of a Renaissance man, Chinese men, especially in the upper class, were encouraged to learn. These six arts were archery, calligraphy, chariot riding, music, mathematics, music, and rites. During the Han Dynasty, another influential figure in the development of Chinese martial arts came to the forefront of the movement. He was an infamous physician and surgeon, known as Hao Chu. Besides being credited with discovering anesthesia, the well-known doctor filled in the gap regarding medicine in the Yellow Emperor's teachings. Another gigantic contribution from Hao Chu to Kung Fu was the development of exercise techniques that had numerous health benefits for his patients. These techniques were based on animals he had observed. He developed a system that would later be used in Shaolin-born Kung Fu techniques, using those movements he observed. More centuries passed, with various fighting styles, techniques, and life philosophies cultivated in mainland China. It wasn't until a foreign Buddhist monk from southern India, Bodhidharma, visited the country that Kung Fu was formed. Bodhidharma came to mainland China sometime between 450 and 500 AD. The details of how he got there and his travels across the country are unclear. There are not a lot of records of his travels. What is known is that he originally came to teach and spread the word of what would become known as Shaosheng Buddhism. The arrival of Bodhidharma was heralded by Indian royalty, requesting that the kingdoms of China take good care of their monk who came to spread the teachings of Buddha. Wherever he went, the Chinese were eager to see him, to hear him speak, and to learn from him. But they were surprised when, instead of speaking, he simply meditated. Some were intrigued, others were confused, and there were even those who were angered. Whatever the reaction, most of the Chinese populace he came across did not fully understand what he was preaching. With that said, word of him and his radical teachings spread. Eventually, tales of Da Mo, who is Bodhidharma, the Indian meditating monk, reached the ears of the ruler of China's southern kingdom, Emperor Wu. A devout Buddhist, the emperor made a point to erect monuments, statues, and temples dedicated to the religion. So when he heard of this Indian monk with a new take on what he loved, he just had to meet him. There's a famous story of the first interaction between Emperor Wu and Bodhidharma. The emperor inquired whether or not the monk thought that the leader's dedication to Buddhism and generous donations to the religious institutions were good and moral. And to his surprise, the monk said, no. When he asked if a Buddha was living in their world, again the monk said, no. It probably goes without saying, but Bodhidharma's answers kind of upset Emperor Wu. The reasoning was simple and demonstrated how the monk saw the world and what he promoted through his teachings. Emperor Wu's grand donations to temples and Buddhist institutions were not something to brag about or be proud of. As the monk saw it, this was a leader's duty. Even asking if a Buddha was living among them displayed a clear lack of faith in the religion. Bodhidharma was ordered to leave the kingdom and never return. After his exile for Emperor Wu's kingdom, Bodhidharma's trip up to the northern part of China brought him to a gathering in the village of Nanjing. There he came across a former prolific general named Sheng Guang. Guilt over all the people he'd killed, directly or indirectly, and the effects that he had on his victims' friends and families, led him to become a Buddhist monk. On this day in Nanjing, Sheng Guang addressed a crowd of villagers, teaching them traditional Buddhist lessons. Bodhidharma listened to him and reacted accordingly, whether he agreed with what he was being said or he didn't. The fact that this foreigner would have the nerve to shake his head and not agree with his lessons angered a Sheng Guang. That anger boiled over to the point that the former general snatched the Buddhist beads from around the monk's neck and threw some of them at him, hitting him in the face, bloodying him, and knocking out a few teeth. Naturally, Sheng Guang thought his angry outburst would produce a confrontation with the South Indian monk. Surprisingly,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.